both of our players who have fought really hard to get to this spot.
They're both really strong players.
Oh my goodness, what a game!
We are ready to get this match underway.
Good afternoon to all our friends at home here from Lock and Load Game Fest 2015 in Bellevue, Washington. This is the second round of the Iron Gauntlet War Machine and Hordes World Championship 2015. I'm Michael Plummer, Convention Coordinator for Privateer Press.
And I'm Will Hungerford, Organized Play and Volunteer Coordinator for Privateer Press.
And today we are going to be sitting down and we're going to be talking about the second round game. We've got Trent Denison playing Crix.
He's playing War Witch Denegra.
That's correct. And he is hailing all the way from Australia.
Yeah. Versus Jamie Perkins coming from the UK. And he's going to be playing Epic Sorcia again. So we see a second game with Epic Sorcia.
Great. Why don't you go ahead and talk a little bit about Jamie's list?
So Jamie's list, he's got a Bonded Conquest in it. So we saw how nasty that was last time. He's got the full unit of Winter Guard Infantry, along with the Winter Guard Standard and Officer. Three of the Rocketeers attached. He's got a full unit of Selena and the Nis with Valachev attached. The Great Bears, Epic Alexia to get all those yummy, yummy souls coming off all the units dying. Silas, of course, good old Covenant Grigorovich to help all these Winter Guard out. And the Gobber Tinkerer is a little bit of backup for that conquest.
All right, so Trent Denison, though, is playing Denegra 1 against him. So we're going to have Warwitch Denegra, two Night Wretches, a Scarlock Thrall to help pitch out some more spells. He has Lord Rockbottom, Master Gunner Dougal McNeil, a Warwitch Siren, Iacos, Scourge of the Meridius, a Pistol Wraith, a minimum unit of Gregor Boomhauer and Company, Silena Riffle and the Nis Hunters, two Necrosurgeon and Stitch Thralls, the Wither Shadow Combine, and the Devil Shadow Mutineers.
Yeah.
He also has the Mechana Thralls with their unit attachment.
This list is just awesome to look over. It's so spicy. There's just a lot going on here.
It's going to be really interesting to see how this thing plays. There's a lot of synergies between the Merc Solos and the Devil Shadow Mutineers and everyone that they're with. I'm really excited to see how this game pans out. I think it's going to be a lot of fun to watch.
I think we're going to see a ton of infantry die.
Absolutely. There's a ton of infantry.
There's a ton of single wound infantry that are just going to fall over.
Absolutely. Our scenario today is fire support. Will, why don't you tell us about fire support?
So fire support is one of the objective scenarios. So you've got two flags. One is friendly to each player. Same for the objectives. This is a kill box scenario, so the players have to be very careful about how close they end up with their warcasters or warlocks, if we were playing hordes, to the edges, so they don't start giving away CPs to their opponent. This is a scenario where you will dominate for one control point on your friendly flag. If you can get to the enemy flag and control or dominate, you'll really start racking up some points. But to do so, you have to destroy the enemy objective, because the enemy objective does contest the flag.
Absolutely.
So destroying that objective is going to get you a CP, and then if you're in a position to really get on top of that flag, you can start snowballing into a scenario win very quickly.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite scenarios, actually. I love playing this one. And here we see the players shaking hands, always great sports. Love to see that. And they're going to start their clocks, and we are going to begin with deployment. Pre-deployment on that conquest. Why don't you talk through this. What are your thoughts on Jamie's deployment?
Well, I also, there's a rad kung fu match going on in the background right now, which is pretty neat. But Matt Clark is our judge for this game. Just want to give him a quick heads up and some props. He's one of our judges coming out of Canada. He's a great guy. But let's see what we got going on. Looks like it's just all Jamie right now. He has the first turn, so the pre-deployment was just a matter of the conquest having to go down first. So looks like Jamie's got an objective in a trench near his flag. I like that the flags, you'll see that Jamie's flag, the one that's closer to the side, is a Cadoran flag, and then Trent's is a Crixan flag, so it's going to be very easy to tell where those are.
Yep.
But let's see. We got Jamie. There's Sorcia right up there. Set up the Winter Guard. Wouldn't be surprised if they sort of pack into that, or at least in the important solos and the officer pack into that trench and hang back while he gets the Winter Guard in position to move in and do some damage, because he's got a lot of infantry to chew through. I mean, luckily he has a conquest as well to do some real damage.
Yeah, and he's setting up the Nis Hunters on his other flank. He's going to have a really solid flank on both sides. I don't think he's going to have any trouble with board control with the number of models he has.
No, absolutely not. And we get a better look at the map. I believe there was probably, there's the forest like in the middle of the table and then one closer to Trent's side. So not very surprising. That's where the Nis will probably be heading.
Yeah, we're going to see them playing in there a lot. Keep them alive.
Yeah, so we'll likely see Sorcia in that trench probably for the majority in the game, unless he starts moving her towards that linear obstacle and is going for the domination on the enemy flag later towards the game. I'd be very surprised if that happens early unless he wants to get incredibly aggressive.
Well, you know, with Cyclone, he's going to be able to cover a lot of ground really fast, so he doesn't even need to be near that flag.
Right, right.
So we're moving over to the Crixian deployment. So Trent here is picking up all his models. His hand's kind of in the way. So right now he's setting up that unit of Gregor Boomheller & Co. They set up right in the center of the table. I'm not surprised by that at all. They're a very beefy unit. They're gonna last for a long time with the use of their,
the Call of Defiance
ability.
That's
it, Call of Defiance, yep. The 4-plus tough that everyone raves about with Boomhowlers.
It's real good.
It's pretty fantastic. looks like he's setting up his Night Wretch on the right, and has he set Denegri yet? It's kind of hard to tell from here. I don't know. He's got a whole spread. He's got so much infantry in this list. It's going to be a lot to chew through, and he's creating a nice wide frontage. I can't tell what he's got left. There we go. So we're looking at the Mechanithralls directly to the left of the Boomhowlers, and the Nis Hunters are covering the flank again on the side of that forest. Denegar has not yet been placed, and none of his Merc Solos have. Now he's putting in his Devil Shadow Mutineers. They're one of my favorite units. Man, they're a lot of fun to play.
Who do you think is going to win the Nis on Nis battle that's about to come up with these two casters in the train?
I think it's going to be Selena. I think Selena's Nis Hunters are going to take it.
Yeah?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no doubt in my mind.
Absolutely, thanks.
Yes. No, I have no idea. You know, both these casters support that unit really well, so.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. Trent played in the overnight tournament last night until 7 a.m.
Yep.
And is now in the Iron Gauntlet. So that man right there is a machine.
He's just
non-stop war machine.
I'm very excited to see how he does then, because I know that when I don't sleep and I lose my cool. Like I have no idea what I'm doing. Yeah,
those are words that would describe that. Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to seeing someone not do that. In our last game, I would have tilted early in what was happening to Olav, but he stayed through and he almost won that.
Yeah, it was really cool about this game. I don't know if we mentioned it before, but almost half the field right now in Iron Gauntlet are all international players.
Yeah, 7 of the 16 actually.
Yeah, and we're getting to see Jamie Perkins and Trent Denison. These are two incredibly well-known international players face off in what is also going to be an awesome match.
All right, so the Cator turn has started. Looks like Iron Flesh on the Nis Hunters and Boundless Charge on the Conquest. No surprises here.
Nope. Sorcerer's just making a standard advance, getting in position.
Call that the Sorcerer Shuffle.
No one's ever called it that.
I just did.
Well, okay. So it looks like the Conquest is getting his free charge off because of Boundless Charge.
Yep.
I'm not sure who he was targeting, but plenty of targets straight ahead to just get that extra movement.
Absolutely.
Looks like during her activation, Sorsha also desperate paced the Winter Guard and told him to go hurry up.
Yeah, those extra couple inches, it doesn't sound like much, but it can really amount to a lot over the course of the game.
Jamie's obviously trying to get a strong position on the board control early on so he can, looks like get the Alpha Strike and really force Trent's hands on how he has to react to him.
Absolutely.
Be more proactive than reactive.
He's got really good placement on those Winter Guard, too. They're not too close to one another, so he's not going to lose a lot to an early Venom or anything like that. So really smart play here from Jamie. Not that I'd expect anything less. But I always say, one of my favorite things about watching this level of game is they know exactly where they want to put their models, especially early in the game. They kind of have that planned out right away.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Can you imagine being one of these Winter Guard? Like, you go through the training of the academy and everything, and, you finally get ready to go, fight for your nation. Maybe go fight some Signarans or some of the Sully's invaders. And your first battle, you have the privilege of fighting alongside a Warcaster, and just zombies and monsters show up.
Yeah, yeah. And you're wearing a coat, and it's not even snowing.
Yeah. You're like, I didn't sign up for any of this. No. Those are monsters.
That would be terrifying.
Yeah.
So those Nis Hunters, looks like a run.
Yeah, that's definitely a run. Not going their full distance, though.
No. Why would?
Yeah, I think when we brought it up earlier, who wins the Selena versus Selena mirror match here? It's Alexia, too, because she just gets all their souls.
That's absolutely true.
Right. So, even if they both obliterate each other, Lexi 2 is quite happy with what's going on.
Yeah, for sure. Alexia, too. It's a model I don't see a lot of people playing locally. She's very strong.
Yeah.
She can be a murder machine.
She can, and she's got some really strong abilities. Some that you always have to remember when your opponent's playing her. Like, if you forget Arcane Vortex, you're going to have a very bad time.
Yes, that is absolutely true.
Yeah.
If I ever played against her, I would have a very bad time.
Yeah, I could see that happening. Hey, you want to play a game after this?
Yeah, let's do it.
I got a Caterer list. I'm going to try.
Oh, cool.
Sorcerer 2 list. You might have seen it.
Oh, cool. I'll play a Spell Heavy Army.
Oh, yeah. Bring your Ron list.
Yeah, done.
We'll have a good time.
So Alexia's coming up on the flank there.
Yep.
Good place for her. It's one of those things I love about cavalry models. They're really good at moving into position from anywhere on the board because of their high speed.
Yeah. And looks like that token on the Nis was Iron Flesh. We might have missed that earlier. So they're currently def a million.
All right. So the turn has passed over to Trent, who allocates no focus.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little surprising to me. And the War Witch Siren power boosts the Night Wretch. Makes perfect sense then.
Yep.
And the Bone Jack is going to run towards the hill. Looks like toe on the hill to get that defense bonus.
Those are going to be some nasty Venoms later. Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah, we'll see.
Jamie's such a good player. He's not going to give him any good lines.
That's true. But you know, you can't really avoid Crippling Grasp.
You can. You just bring nothing but Spell Immune models.
Sure.
Which, you know, Kador
and never,
none.
Ever get within 8 inches of an Arcanine.
Yeah. You know, if you just killbox yourself the whole time.
Yeah. I'm good at that tactic. Boomhounders are running. Nice long run.
I have to imagine that they're Call of Defiancing here.
I'm sure.
I mean
it's the obvious choice.
It's the obvious choice.
He's going to do something else now, and we're going to look like idiots. Oh, there it is. Call of Defiance.
Yeah, I just got the judge confirmation. It was Call of Defiance, you know.
Congratulations, Will. We know how to play the game.
Well, let's not get ahead of ourselves.
You know how to play the game.
Occasionally.
Sometimes. Jamie is marking up some tokens.
Must be the... Yeah.
Yep.
Covenant Grigorovich. I didn't catch what he did earlier, but I have to assume it was giving tough out to the Winter Guard.
So Wither Shadow Combine advancing, putting themselves in a good place. They can do a lot of damage with their Dark Fires and everything. They're another unit that just has a nice toolbox of abilities. They're gonna.
Yeah, they'll probably be. They got some really high def targets out there, though.
They do. I don't think there's going to be a whole lot of Dark Fire happening, but it's something I like to mention because a lot of people forget about it.
Yeah.
They're definitely there for Puppet Master and the free upkeep and all that.
Oh, of course.
Especially for Denegra. Denegra loves her focus. Iokos is running.
And Iokos doesn't look like he has a jack on him, so he's just going pure super solo mode in this game.
Which is a good thing for him to do. I mean, with stealth and his harpoon and everything he can do, he jumps.
Jumping, dragging, stealthing, journeyman warcaster.
Yep.
Dude's pretty tough.
Yeah, he's a monster.
So, looks like Trent's just advancing his Nis Hunters.
Sure.
You know, being a little bit more conservative. I think he senses the Civil War coming that we've been talking about.
You know, usually when I play Nis Hunters, that's how I like to play them with Crix, too. They're usually my second wave. Like, you can definitely... It's really easy to overextend with a unit that fast.
Mm-hmm.
And they're very fragile once they get hit, so... Especially against a Conquest. I mean, come on.
Yeah, that Conquest is going to be able to do a lot of damage this game.
Mm-hmm. I know that Trent has answers to the Conquest. He just needs to make sure they're in the right place.
Sure. So
Necrosurgeon advancing?
Yep, Necrosurgeon getting in position to start collecting bodies. There are a plethora of them available. You know, and one of the really good things Trent's doing is Trent chose Armory as his objective for this list. The Armory provides a bonus to Light Artillery, and its secondary benefit is it has that ability when it would die, you can kill somebody else within 4 inches of it, a friendly model. So this Crix list in particular has some nice recursion in it. So if Trent doesn't want that objective to die, he can probably keep it from dying for a very long time.
Very long time with those Mechanothralls.
Jamie, on the other hand, he chose Effigy of Valor. So he's got that, that fearless aura,
yep.
And the Effigy of Valor also provides cover with the obstruct rule. So if Sorsha wanted to be in that position, you know, you have to be very careful with it because you see a lot of people move up and take the cover from Effigy, but they can just blow it up.
Yeah.
Right. So you just have to be very careful about when you do that. But
especially with a caster like Sorsha. Sorsha takes a hit, she crumples.
And I almost forgot the objectives in a trench already providing cover. So right. That's irrelevant.
So the Devil Shine Mutineers are running up on the hill.
Yep.
I said it before, I love this unit. They do so much work.
Yeah. I have a ton of fun with them in my Cephalix list. You put a Dominator on them. If the Dominator does die, once they're done running and they come back, you can use them to kill a guy and bring the Dominator back to life. Which is just, I mean, it's not like game-breaking, but it's fun. I'm really interested to see what Trent does with the Devil Shadow, what he's looking to pull off with them in this list, and what kind of damage they're going to do here.
Yeah, it's I don't know, they give a lot of options, right? They've got guns, they've got swords, they come back to life.
I mean, Isla's Sight, two pistols with Weapon Master, like...
That's a thing.
She's a monster. Looks like Denegra is running, so...
That's...
Just keeping her focus,
yeah,
get in a position.
Keep her focus, get in position. You know, he didn't put that Arcanine too far forward. He doesn't really have any targets. It's a good move for her. Scarlock running.
So...
Last Necro Surgeon running. Yeah, they're just just putting his stuff in position where he wants it.
Yep, second unit of Necro, the Stitch Thralls and the Necro Surgeon. Just getting ready to get more bodies. Yep.
It's a beautiful army, by the way. Trent has done a lovely job.
Yeah, I like
painting his Crix.
I dig it. Speaking of which, Jamie's Conquest, it's looking real snappy.
Yeah, I like it a lot. I love watching these games. I love watching fully painted armies on the battlefield.
I agree. So Jamie's turn is starting. Let's see how he's going to allocate some of his focus. He's checking his kill box. If you ever forget what player is Jamie Perkins during this game, just watch his shirt.
Yep. Unless he switches shirts with Trent, in which case there will be problems.
That'd be a real weird thing to happen in the middle of an Iron Gauntlet game.
It would
just
be.
Like, they just stop and change shirts. Maybe they can hear the commentary.
You never know.
Jamie's just thinking right now,
yep.
Where's that focus going to go? What am I going to do?
What am I going to kill? All right, looks like he's allocating single focus to the Conquest. At least so far.
I wonder if Jamie's looking at a... You know, obviously, Creeping Barrage with the Conquest has some fun application here of being able to stop... I mean, the Nyss Civil War that's happening up towards the top of the table, he can really mess with that. But I wonder if he's looking at, like, crit devastation possibilities on the big gun.
You can't
bank on it, right? You absolutely cannot plan for it because things can go very wrong.
Here's the thing, though. Like, if you look at Trent's side of the board, those troops are really bunched up. Mm-hmm. So he get a lot of targets with the hit, and then if he does get that devastation, that's amazing.
Well, the Conquest is moving up.
Here in the quarterfinals, we just got an update. Jay Larson has already won versus Olav Winroth, and Ryan Cherboga has defeated Tom Guan in the second round. So there's a little update on some other winners.
Okay.
Congratulations to those guys.
Yep, absolutely. So Conquest is getting all the way in there. Looks like of the spells that were upkept on Sorcerer's End, it's just Iron Flesh, and that is the token that's up on the Nyss. Towards the top.
I don't expect we'll see that come off of that unit.
I think when they all die, it will drop.
Maybe.
Maybe. We'll see.
Might cast on the souls on Alexia.
So we got a big shot coming here.
So Jamie's the big gun. He might be looking for that crit dev.
Got it.
And there it is.
Oh, this is going to be ugly. Even with them going 2 inches, everybody's packed together so much. We got a lot of guys just flying into each other here.
Flying all over the place. If you ever watch Popcorn Pop?
No, I usually don't.
Well, but if you think about it, it's just all over the place.
I usually don't think about it either.
I I get bored at night.
Okay, no, it makes sense to me. So it looks like the judges, they're just looking over the rules for crit devastation right now, making sure they resolve this correctly.
Yeah, I mean, and it's an ability you don't see on a whole lot of models. So
right.
I'm not surprised that they're looking at that one. They want to make sure they get it completely right.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, while they're going over this, still got the rest of Lock and Lich one, Game Fest 2015 in full swing over here. The Five Fingers Tattoo Parlor is going very well, all full up. A lot of people showing their faction pride. People playing Iron Arena. Yeah. Almost all the tables in this room are filled. Jason Souls right now is doing his Unbound exhibition. So some big games happening. It's a really good time over here. I'm really enjoying myself.
Yeah. Lock and Lich's always a good time.
Yeah, that is the truth.
If you've never been before and you really like War Machine and Hordes or anything Privateer Press makes, you should come out to it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's good. So it looks like what they're doing is they're figuring out a specific interaction between Crit Dev and Dougal McNeil's Hit the Deck.
Oh.
The judges are discussing it right now.
Yeah, that's an interesting one.
Man, that Conquest. Looking
yeah,
real, real snappy there. So
I love that model.
Oh yeah, it's so Kador, right?
Yeah, it's everything you want out of it. It's boxy, it's punchy, it's big. Yeah.
So while they're looking stuff over, how was the last game? You know, I was running around judging some other tables.
Yeah, you know, the last game was really exciting. It was Fist of Halak versus yeah. Sorcha 2, and mm-hmm. for pretty much the whole game, Watt was dominating the table until round 5, I believe.
Yeah.
We saw a charge from Sorcha right into Xerxes, and man, he almost pulled it off, but he whiffed the last couple attacks, and that was that.
Oh.
And, you know, Watt was beating his chest and letting out shudder breaths like he was scared.
Cool.
It was a great game to watch. Okay, it looks like they've got it
yep.
all sorted out. Dougal's not hit at all, is what they're ruling has been.
Yeah, we had both Tim Bankey and Matt Clark. It was kind of a tough call, so
absolutely.
Yep, get some extra judge support in there. Make sure we're doing things correctly.
Our judges do a great job. There are a lot of very complex interactions of rules in War Machine and Hordes, and man, they just know it all. And yep. more power to them.
So here we see the crit devastation, the throws happening, the collateral damage being resolved. So there's gonna be some dice rolls here, and I assume we're gonna have several dead models. Looks like that Wither Shadow Combine survived, but, you know, it was knocked down.
Knocked down, yep. But a couple Mechanothralls dead so far. Did not see what he just... Did he remove a model there?
Didn't see if he did. There might be a Mechanothral hiding behind that cylinder there. Mm. Looks like the ruling for Dougal is that, you know, with Hit the Deck... He was basically unaffected.
Yes, that is what the ruling was.
So Jamie's firing the secondary battery, not setting down any creeping barrages instead of attacking. So doing the left side first. Ooh, those dice rolls looking a little rough. So we've got a deviation. Here comes the AoE. Player's doing an awesome job of resolving an AoE over an obstruction, which can always be pretty rough.
Absolutely.
Now, it looks like with the right gun, I see Jamie grabbing the two AoEs, so I have to imagine he's going to Creeping Barrage. He's just checking his line of sight right now. Yeah, so right side of the Conquest went with Creeping Barrage.
Mm-hmm. It's a great ability, Creeping Barrage.
definitely effective in this match. Mm-hmm. You know, the boom howlers, they care about it a little less. Their armor's high enough that it's pretty unlikely they're going to die from it. But
yeah, sitting on a 16, I mean, you're looking for hard 11s to kill them, but probably not going to happen.
The Nis and the Mechanithralls, it's got to be considered.
Definitely.
Sorsha's moving up, getting in a good spot. He's checking his kill box. He's making sure he's not going to kill box himself, just being right in there.
I never remember to do that. Sorsha is within the kill box, though, so she's safe.
I imagine she would. I imagine you don't walk up, measure the kill box, then confirm you're in it and stop moving.
I mean, you might.
You might. I mean, if it's just the end of the day and you're like, I can't do this anymore.
I need to go to bed.
I need to go to bed. And you just don't feel like conceding for some reason.
Yeah.
You're just...
Yeah. Never say die. Just do it.
When she moved up, she desperate paced the winter guard.
Of course.
Expect that to happen, you know, pretty regularly.
As you can see, we got some people watching the big games. Everybody's really excited to see what happens this year. It's quite fitting that Kidoran banner is right above Jamie Perkins.
Oh, I didn't even notice that. It's nice, nice right there. Nice little bit of imagery.
Little chance.
So the Bobbin and Weaving Winter Guard are making their way up. You know,
got Bjabin Weave.
Bjabin Weave?
Bjabin Weave.
Bjabin Weave.
So it's a...
B-Y-O-B and Weave? Bjabin Weave?
Bjabin Weave.
Bjabin Weave.
That's correct.
Okay, good.
Yep, got to make them a little lot harder to kill. We are idiots.
Right.
Kavik Joe for the Motherland. I'll get some boosted attacks for those Winter Guard.
Right, and they've already got combined arms because of Sorsha's elite cadre. So, mm-hmm. like, we're talking if we throw some CRAs out there, but it's probably not going to happen. What I anticipate...
Not with the boosted attacks, I doubt it.
No. What I think is going to happen is we're going to see the grape shots instead. You know, we're gonna see the sprays.
We're gonna see some boosted grape shots hitting multiple targets, and he's gonna be looking for some spikes on the boom howlers and hopefully taking out some of the lower armor stuff behind them.
Man, Danny is right up there. That feet turn is going to be
brutal.
It depends on what he does. I mean, he might feel too pressured. I mean, he's probably safe. It is Denegra, but there's a lot of nasty things over there. There's a lot of nasty things that you know.
Well, let's be honest, Will. Both these lists are entirely nasty. There's nothing on that table I'm not scared of. I mean, except maybe Dougal.
I am
if
not.
If Dougal charges me, I'm fine.
You sure about that? I'm not scared of a Stitch Thrall. I'd say a single Stitch Thrall doesn't bother me.
That is a monster with a bag full of bodies. I'm terrified.
Well, I mean, in real life, absolutely.
Sure.
Absolutely. You know, there's also, you know, the, like, the junk hobo back there with his wagon walking around. That guy's got a pistol, by the way.
Does he really?
Yeah. The Gobber Tinker?
Found it in the cart. All right, so we have some attacks being made here.
Found it in the cart. Just reaches back there. Hey, guys, look what I got.
Making careful decisions about where these shots are going.
It matters, I mean. It's the first engagement of the game, so taking out some of these models is very important.
Yep, absolutely.
Here comes those grape shots. Plenty of targets.
Deck grape shot.
All right, so the first Boomhauler down. Next Boomhauler. Down.
So Boomhauer here, X'd out.
These are on these 4+ tough rolls.
Yeah. Lost a model here.
Wow. Trent's tough rolls are failing him here.
I think there was one here as well.
Yeah, there was another one of them.
So it's 3 so far. Some nice rolls here.
Whew. So the Arknode just took 8 damage from one of the Rocketeers.
This Arknode right here. That guy's damage.
And that guy took damage earlier from the
Devastation.
No, from the AoE from the secondary battery that ended up deviating over. I think Jamie rolled like an 11 on the blast damage.
Another Boomhauler down. That is...
Wow.
That is downright improbable. All right. So that's some pretty heavy losses, all things considered.
Yeah, I mean, it's a decent number of models. It's, a surprising number of losses, given the buffs they had on them. Sometimes then the dice turn right back against you.
And that's absolutely true, but losing the Boomhowlers especially, they don't come back.
They don't. Well, they come back as Mechanothralls.
Sure, that's true, but not as Boomhowlers. I mean, Gobber Tinker's not going to find one in the cart.
Junk hobo.
Pardon me.
So, looks like the front row of the Winter Guard here on the bottom end of the screen are just making some CRA, some standard attacks at the models they have range to.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a rocket attack going on one of the Devil Shadow Mutineers.
That's Syrah, actually. Mm-hmm.
That is the one with the two pistols, Isla Sight. She is a nightmare.
Yeah.
She fails her tough check, and she is out.
That's not the one you want to lose, that's for sure.
But she's only out for now, right?
That's true.
All it takes is one of the other guys getting there.
Targeting Moreland with a rocket.
Yep. So it looks like it missed. Looks like it deviates back. Hits nothing.
Yep. That poor dirt.
Winter Guard doing a lot of damage.
Yeah, they are. Winter Guard are fantastic unit.
Yep.
With Kovnik Joe and the extra support that Sorcha
Kovnik
gives.
Kovnik Gregorovich.
Yeah. Kovnik Joseph Gregorovich.
All right, good. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm on a first name basis with that guy.
Oh.
Yeah. We go to lunch every week.
So, you know if the models are talking to you, something has gone very wrong, right?
What?
No? Okay, no. Let's not talk about it again. See some of the other IG games going on in the background?
Yep. It's an impressive hall and a lot of people playing a lot of games. A lot of people having a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. There's a spell draft and hardcore going on right now, in addition to a War Machine Tactics tournament, an Unleashed RPG adventure. Just a lot going on in that hall.
Zombie Survivor Series coming up soon?
Yeah.
So that was an attack from Alexia.
Alexia walks up.
Another Boomhowler taken out.
Yeah.
And that was a Boomhowler here. So we've lost coverage in pretty much this entire area.
All right, though. I you know, Trent's turn is going to be equally devastating.
Oh,
a lot
yeah.
of those Wonder Guard are not going to survive this.
So the Nis Hunters are moving up. Toe in the woods.
Yep. We're going to stay safe behind the woods. I mean, obviously, the other Nis don't care, but these Nis have iron flesh on them.
That's correct.
And that's a problem.
Well, only for the Nis.
Only for the Nis. It's not a problem for the Nis, but it's a problem for the Nis.
Yeah. This is going to be real confusing.
No, I completely understand what's happening.
Me too. I know nothing.
How do you think, and I know you've played a ton of Kricks.
Oh, yeah.
So, if you're running Trent's list, mm-hmm. what's your plan to deal with the Conquest? Do you just ignore it?
You know,
or... obviously, that's not a great idea, but what's your plan?
I think my plan is hopefully the feet turn, but although that you can't really count on that because you got to use the feet when you need to use it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think between Parasite and combo strikes from the Mechanithralls, and that'll put a lot of hurt into the thing.
Do you think the Mechanithralls are even going to get there?
I don't think they'll get there in their initial wave. Those Necrosurgeons are going to be bringing back a lot of extra Mechanithralls every turn.
Yep.
I think that's the answer. Maybe I'm wrong. And maybe some Nis Hunter Weapon Master attacks in there as well.
Yeah. Well, Trent's an excellent player, so really looking to see what he's going to pull off in his turn.
Yeah, I'm taking notes, that's for sure.
But right now, the Nis, they're still activating. They just got done advancing, and they're going to put some shots out. Start dropping some shots into some Boomhowlers.
Drop it like it's shot.
Oh.
That happened.
No, that was fantastic.
You're welcome.
So it looks like the first shots from the Nis hit the Boomhowler, the one closest to the woods, but didn't break his armor. That'll do, though. Hey, and look at that. Looks like he made a tough roll.
That'll do, Nis. That'll do. So that is a passed tough check. First one we've seen. But mathematically, that works because one out of five is roughly half.
Yeah. Yeah. Wait. Yeah. No, yeah. I agree.
Checking the ranges on a couple more nits. CRA.
Making another tough roll.
Another pass tough. So dice are turning around. See Jamie marking the models that have already shot. It's
always nice.
Yeah, it's helpful.
In any tournament you play in, there's always a little level of, I don't want to say stress, but just like, you got a lot going on, right? And it can be easy to forget something that's very important to you. So anything you can do or get in the habit of doing that helps you not forget key or important things is always good.
Absolutely.
And it's good for your opponent. Like, the more you can communicate information to them so that there's never a dispute, it's always great.
And that's the thing I love about seeing these players play is they're all super friendly with one another. They're laughing. They're having a good time. And there's no gotchas. There's no secrets. Like, everyone wants to play a nice, clean, fair game.
You know, I think War Machine's really known for having a competitive community and an overall gaming community that's fairly friendly and very accommodating. We see James Morehouse in the background watching his buddy Trent play.
Yeah.
They had a fantastic showing in the team tournament overnight, as I mentioned earlier. In fact, I think their team won.
Did they? That's fantastic. Good for them.
Trent got his 2 hours of sleep, then showed up to Iron Gauntlet, and here he is. So.
Jamie's put a lot of thought into the game. War Machine really is kind of a thinking man's game. You got to consider all the possibilities.
So it looks like the Gobber Tinkerer picked up his junk wagon and ran with it to get up next to the Conquest. Expected some repairs next turn.
That's some impressive cardio. That wagon's heavy.
It's got a gun in it.
Yeah. That's not safe.
So Jamie ships the turn back to Trent.
You can see Trent's mascot, the drop bear. Watching the game. We have warned the dropper that he's not allowed to give any tips or hints, though. So there will be no misconduct.
Ah. You have a thing about talking to inanimate objects. But it's okay.
I mean, I wouldn't call it a thing.
Oh, a belief?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So it's Trent's turn to strike back. Time for him to start taking out some of these models.
It's Trent's turn to think about what he's going to do.
It is Trent's turn to go into the tank.
I mean, and just look at the clock. 51 minutes to 36 minutes.
Yeah.
That was a turn. It took some time. There's a lot of stuff to do, and there's a lot of thinking to do. So,
yeah.
You're going to see a lot of that.
And this is the bottom of turn two. This means scoring on the flags is live, though I find it highly unlikely we're going to see any flag scoring happen this turn.
Probably not.
No, I say that. These players will surprise us left and right.
Absolutely.
Right.
Happens all the time.
Like,
they love to make us look stupid.
Wow, I wasn't going to put it that way, but sure, yeah, no.
It's not hard, so. Calculating his thoughts, what he wants to do very carefully. You can kind of see one of his ticks there. He plays with his tape measure. He bends it back and forth. I love noticing those. It interests me. I don't know why.
You're a weird guy, Michael Plummer, but I love you.
Thanks, man.
No problem. So, I mean, clearly we're going to see Zero from the Devil Shadow Mutineer get brought back this turn. You can see the charge lane right there.
Yep.
The Boom Howlers are going to go in. There's not many of them left.
Two?
I'm really interested to see what Trent's going to pull off with his Nis here. Like, what's his plan, right? Like, look what you're facing down. That whole flank, you've got the higher def Nis, you've got Alexia, and then you've got the Conquest. Like, do you shift back down and try and move them towards a fight that they can win, or are you going to try and maybe just jam them up with some high def models?
Trent's got a couple options here with him. I mean, obviously he could come around this way and try and take out Alexia and the Nis, but those Nis have Iron Flesh, so that's going to be a problem. They can also scoop around this way here and come in and wipe out those Winter Guard, because those Winter Guard are going to cause a problem. They've been doing it the whole game. There's a couple of Boom Howlers left. I imagine that they're going to try and tie up as many of the Winter Guard as they can because they have the larger bases there. But a lot of things you can do, a lot of thoughts to process.
What do you think the chances are we're going to see a defensive or a primarily defensive Denegra feed here? And when I say that, I mean, like, she feeds, gets everybody a little bit debuffed, but it's primarily for him to get in a better position to be able to strike the next turn.
I don't know if he can afford it with the Conquest on the table.
I don't either. I'm just wondering if that's even a consideration. I mean, it's...
I think that if Jamie can force his hand into that, it'll be a really strong play for him. But I think that Trent is going to hold on to that to deal with the Conquest. Because if he can take out that Conquest, that's 19 points out of 50. That's a huge chunk. So he's got to be thinking about trying to take that out. Wither Shadow Combine advancing.
Yeah. So the one that was knocked down from the crit devastation from the Conquest earlier. Four-footed action to stand up so it can move.
Yep.
And we're either going to see some puppet strings or just some magic, and it's probably going to be magic.
Probably magic.
Now.
Ooh, it's magic. Okay, so just cast him.
So they get a puppet string. Got cast with Denegra, and then looks like a spell being thrown out there.
Mm-hmm. Looks like a miss.
So Denegra's obviously going to go a little aggro this turn.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, if you look at the board, there are quite a few options for Denegra.
In terms of Venom?
In terms of Venoms.
Absolutely. Oh, whoa. There we go.
So, if you look at the Winter Guard, he's here in a line. You got a nice line here he could Venom. If he can manage to get an Arcanode in place, this is a nice strong Venom as well.
Yeah, but you're basically trading your Arcanode for, what, 3 Winter Guard at that point? Because that thing is dead.
You think so?
With Joe there and them having CRA with combined arms, that thing is dead. Like, where's she gonna, unless she feats or crippling grasp them or in some other manner stops them from being able to retaliate.
He's got 2 arc nodes, though. It might be worth it, right? Because those Winter Guard are putting out a lot of damage.
Maybe. Maybe it gets a position to drop multiple Venoms and try and take out, what, half of the unit?
I mean, that,
we'll see.
I mean, Night Rich is only 4 points.
It is, but, I mean, Denegra likes her arc nodes.
That's also very true.
So it looks like Rock Bottom's moving up, and I imagine he's going to use one of his coins.
Probably.
Possibly a little flamethrower. I can't see exactly how close he is to that Winter Guard if it's range.
I'm
looks like they were just confirming that Rock Bottom could fit through that space.
Of course. Payday on the Mutineers, that's what I thought it was going to be.
Oh, yeah.
Giving them boosted melee attack rolls. And when they destroy a model with a normal melee attack, after it's resolved, they can advance up to an inch.
Yeah, overtake.
Yeah, pretty fancy.
Oh, it's disgusting on these guys.
It's pretty good.
Old Captain Two Swords gets to get in there and do some real damage.
That's not his name.
You don't know that. So we've come up with Old Captain Two Swords and Junk Hobo today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to play some real confusing games next week.
Looks like Warwick Siren walks up and is venoming.
Misses both Winter Guard.
Well, I mean, with Bob and Weave up.
With Bob and Weave, she's, what, a 7 magic ability?
The Warwick Siren?
Yeah, magic ability
she's
7.
These guys are not easy to hit.
No, they're not.
It's a lot of high def. I mean, Jamie's list provides some pretty interesting problems you got to solve. You got a lot of high defense, good volume of attacks, obviously a strong, heavy armor. Colossal.
Conquest, yeah.
Gotta be able to deal with.
It's kind of a something for everyone and everything for someone.
Well, here come the Devil Shadow Mutineers, charging through that pistol wraith hanging out on the edge of the hill.
I wonder what it feels like to charge through a ghost.
It probably feels terrible.
I'd imagine it's cold.
Why?
They always say that when a ghost touches you, it's cold. If ghosts.
Who says that?
Do you watch anyway?
Do I watch what? Ghostbusters?
There is no plumber. There's only
educated people know.
Oh, educated ghost hunters?
Correct. So we got some attacks coming out. These dice are real small. Kind of hard to see what the results are on those.
Yeah, I figure we'll know by the fact that the model gets picked up.
If the model's removed.
Yeah. So that guy is clearly dying because Zira is coming back. Right back into play. So Jamie was checking to see if he had take up because that was a Rocketeer that got picked up.
So that would be 1 inch, correct?
Yeah. Nope. Looks like those two Winter Guard are dead. Zero's been brought back into play.
Good for Zero.
Man, Devil Shadow and Mutineers are just...
Yeah.
Look at all smiling over there in the corner. Look at her. Like, just like, yeah, brought him back. Because that's what they sound like now, by the way. I'm giving them a voice. Yeah, brought my friend back. Clearly, I should never name or voice anything in War Machine.
I just saw Wilshick take note of that. Thank you, Wilshick.
They're checking range from Denegra to that Rocketeer. Looks like they're waiting on a judge call.
You know, while this is happening, in the next 8 or 10 minutes,
yeah,
they're going to start the cosplay transformation of cosplayer Marisha Ray into Scar Raven Main on the stage here at Lock and Load. And we're going to get some shots of that during the game, so it should be
pretty
awesome.
Fancy. That's awesome. Man, I'm usually running in events so much. There's so many other awesome things at Lock and Load I just, forget are happening. Or I'll walk in and be like, what is that? Oh, like, the tattoos going on under the corner right now.
Yeah, it's so
big
rad.
Big line right now of people trying to get their free War Machine tattoos. So cool.
Pistol Race activating. Believe he's aiming.
Yep.
Targeting a Winter Guard, the one right next to the flag.
Okay.
Dice are rolled.
So he kills him, picks up a soul.
One there, picking up a soul. Tasty, tasty souls.
Yeah.
Another Winter Guard here. From that Pistol Wraith.
This is what I was talking about earlier. Like, you come out of the academy, and the first thing you fight are, like, undead pirates and, like, a ghost with guns.
That is a ghost with a gun.
That's a ghost with a gun on a hill. It just sucked Franz's soul out.
That's all right. Never liked Franz anyway. Putting more thought into it. So that Pistol Wraith is going to be able to do a little extra damage and have better chances at hitting the Winter Guard next turn because he's going to be able to boost with those souls.
I mean, he's corporeal right now. That guy's probably going to die.
That's true.
Unless
I keep forgetting about the boosted attacks from Kavik or Gorge.
Oh, yeah. No, Winter Guard will lay down the hurt.
Yeah.
But like I said, there's always a chance that Denegra takes what you can do and removes your strength, right?
That's true. Denegra's activating now, so we're going to find out if that's happening here. I think I'd be surprised to see if he'd hear, but it could definitely happen. Oh, declaring a charge on the Rocketeer.
Yep.
Maybe she is placing herself for that feat.
Yeah, I told you it was a possibility. Yep. So he's getting base-to-base contact with the flag from the charge and then charging the Rocketeer. So he... And then interrupts the charge with the feat. Here comes the Withering. Wow, that is incredibly aggressive.
Yes, it is. If he hadn't just feeded, he'd be in a lot of trouble. But he's got probably at least one turn.
Oh, well, I mean, of course he's feeding there. Like, he's not going to charge.
I'm going to charge straight to the front and not pop my feet.
Yeah. But even then, like, you know, and Trent's clearly got a plan for what he's going
to
do.
He has to.
Right. This is some very aggressive so play.
Marking the models that are hit by the withering.
Yep.
One of the great bears. Sorsha, Conquest, obviously.
So here's the actual charge attack against the Winter Guard model he charged. Oh, I'm sorry. That is a crippling grasp he used against the Winter Guard before actually resolving the melee attack. So you interrupted charge with both feet and crippling grasp.
Crippling grasp. Crippling grasp on that Winter Guard is going to hurt.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Luckily, the desperate pace helps with the movement problem.
Not really.
Speed.
They are so debuffed right now.
Yeah, the feet.
Between feet and crippling grass, there's not much they're doing this turn.
Is that base speed on a Winter Guard?
Base speed on a Winter Guard, you asked?
Yeah.
That's a six.
A six. Oh, they only need 2 inches. Ouch.
Be all right.
Four with desperate pace.
Be all right. You know, and from the model she didn't catch in feet, Deniagra's, she's pretty safe where she's at right now.
Yeah, for sure.
It's just the stuff that's a little bit closer.
Def 16 stealth.
Yeah, Def 16 stealth basically means that Alexia and the Nis being any sort of range.
They're not a problem.
They're
right
not
now.
A range threat, but. Let's see. I'm certain Jamie Perkins has played Deniagra 1 a great many times in his War Machine career.
Absolutely. You know, Deniagra 1, she's one of the casters out of Prime, and she's fantastic. You see her a lot. I used to play her all the time. She's probably one of my favorite casters in Crix.
Yeah. So looks like there was a Venom also coming out of Deniagra, taking out a pair of the Winter Guard.
Winter Guard right around here.
Dougal's walk.
Master Gunner Dougal McNeil advancing.
Yeah, and he forfeited action. He was knocked down earlier from hit the deck happening.
Absolutely.
Here come the Boom Howlers. He walks up and he Rage Howls. So now there's the layers of debuff continue.
Yes. The center's pass command check?
Yep. Yeah.
So it's a Rage Howler.
Yeah. So basically, like, the Conquest, in addition to being suffering the withering right now, is also negative two as attack rolls because of Rage Howler.
The further deforestation of the Iron Kingdoms by players moving trees. This one
well,
is advancing.
Yeah. Trent's confirming that the def on the enemy Nis right now is 19.
That is terrifying.
Pretty good. It's not 19 though. It's 18. Unless there's something I missed earlier. Because Nis are 15 base. Iron Flesh is plus 3.
It's 3.
So I think he might have just asked, are they 19 or 18? We briefly heard him for a second. But this is what looks like a huge CRA.
Yeah, it's like a nine-man CRA.
And that was the model that was contesting
the flag.
The flag. Mm-hmm. Looks like Alexia must be right out.
So the flag here, we had single Nis Hunter here that's just been killed. So this right here is about 4 inches. So Alexia is just out.
Yeah. We imagine so. So it looks like Trent's plan is Denegra feet, control his own flag. I'm sorry, not control his own flag. But he's not going to be able to dominate his own flag. He's just protecting it.
So that's a corpse going on to that stitch straw there.
Why he was concerned about killing the one Nis that was contesting the friendly flag, because the friendly flag is dominate. You can't control the friendly one. It's the enemy one you can control or dominate. I need to get a better look at the map. Maybe there must be some aspects I'm missing here.
I love how carefully they move their models. I love the precision play. So, Bonejack is actually shooting his own Mechanithral here.
Yeah, trying to clear something out here.
Trying to clear something out. Kills it.
Yep.
Corpse token over here.
Yep. So what happened right there is the Bonejack walked up, killed a Mechanithral. Corpse token's picked up by the Necrosurgeon and Stitch Thralls.
Icus advances up to that flag.
Okay.
Interesting. I know Trent has a plan. I don't know what it is.
Yep, he's going to surprise us.
Yep. Just like we said he would. Using that laser sight to determine line of sight. It looks like Echoes is trying to shoot a Mechanithral, I think.
So Iacus threw his spear at a Mechanithral.
Hits it.
Kills it. Gives another corpse out to one of the Necrosurgeons. So now the Necrosurgeon's going to come up and do some, you know, horrible, disgusting work and bring some zombies back to life.
Yeah. It's probably the worst part about fighting zombies. They just keep coming.
Worst part about fighting zombies is the smell. They're dead.
Yeah, there's that.
Necrotechs aren't like freshening them up before battle.
That's true.
Right? You could have a Mechanfidal's been fighting for like 400 years. Like, you smell terrible, sir.
I think after 400 years, you cease smelling.
Maybe they slap new skin on them. I don't know.
That's real creepy, Will.
Well, cricks, man.
Truth.
They're real creepy.
All right. Putting down a template here. Checking some measurements.
Like three Mechanithrals are being spewed into life by the Necrosurgeon here.
So Mechanithrals activate, receive a charge order.
Mm-hmm.
Determining the angle of the charge. Verifying distance. Charging the objective.
Yeah. Yeah, Denny's trying to dominate that flag, so he's trying to get three points this turn.
It seems good.
I mean, that much was becoming apparent as Trent's plan was unfolding. But it's the other flag, the friendly flag, that's got me a little. I'm like, oh, I wonder what he's doing there. Maybe he's just trying to have hard to remove models to contest. I mean,
it's entirely possible.
Aikos is a pretty tough guy. I mean, Alexia's right there, though.
Yeah, Mage Killer. He's what, Def 14, Arm 14. He's got some focus.
So they're just determining the angle of the charge right now. Judge is going to step in with the laser. See, Jamie Perkins is proudly wearing his gold Iron Gauntlet pin. You can only get that for being one of the top 16 finalists in Iron Gauntlet. So they're looking at the charge angle. What they've determined is that the model that just charged, that mechanical charge, just took a free strike from the enormously debuffed Winter Guard.
Yes.
Because of the withering and crippling grasp and just everything that's going on right now, looks like the Mechanthrall survived.
This is a POW 6 on a model passing through.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like the Scarlet Commander ran through Creeping Barrage, Jamie rolled boxcars, and just murdered him.
That is a dead Scarlet Commander.
Well, you know, sometimes you run into... sometimes there's this giant robot, right? And it's just blasting bullets down the ground, and you're like, no, I'll be fine. You're like, I got this,
I
okay?
Got this.
You know, I've watched enough Die Hard movies on Christmas that I can make it through this.
Will? That's how he died the first time.
Bruce Willis?
No, Die Hard? Scarlet Commander.
We don't know how that guy died.
Running into bullets.
Running into bullets. Bullets. My only weakness.
All right, so we got a Mechanthrall out of formation now because of the...
Yeah. The Scarlet Commander dying really, I think, messed up Trent's plan.
Yeah.
I think the Mechanthrall that went for that long charge on the objective
really
now was unable to attack,
yeah,
because he was out of formation.
Trent passes turn and sits down to reassess.
Yep, ships the turn back. I mean, He wasn't able to get all those control points.
Yep.
And that's real unfortunate for Trent. If he had taken that objective out, that's one right there. Dominate that flag. That's three. Then he's got these models under the withering. And if they can't go take care of Denegra just sits there, dominates again.
That would have been game.
And it's game.
But
that's
not happening.
Right?
So things are about to get real interesting.
I mean, I'd have to see a closer look at the exact distances of what would have been able to, like, literally just run over and hope to contest the flag.
Of course.
But that means the models are, well, no, they're new withering. They can't even run.
Oh.
Yeah, Trent, that was an amazing move by Trent. It just
didn't quite work.
Yeah. Scarlock's bullet weakness killed him and ruined the whole plan.
Score still 0-0. What's that?
Oh, man, Trent. Trent must be heartbroken because that plan...
That was a strong play.
It was. It was.
Taking notes.
And that's what you get from guys like this, right?
Absolutely. Every time. Every time I watch one of these games, something shocks me.
Now, Jamie doesn't necessarily have this amazing, you know, easy turn after this.
No.
He's got a ton of models stuck under the withering.
Including the Conquest.
Yeah, including the Conquest. Rage Howler's up. Mm-hmm. So that the Conquest is -2 to attacks in addition to that.
Oh.
Yeah. Then you're rocking a crippling grasp on however many Winter Guard are left, which I didn't get a good count of how many are left, but I'm sure, you know. So Jamie's still in his control phase right now. He's still figuring out, what am I going to do here? How can I retaliate based on what happened and try and swing the tempo back in my direction? So
I mean, there's a lot of tough decisions to be made in this game at this point. I mean, what's Jamie going to do? He's got multiple directions he can go. He can continue to try and you know, take out more troops and win the attrition game, or he can try and go for the scenario. What do you think he's going to do, Will?
You know, I think he's going to put himself in a better position to be able to contest the scenario elements to hold back Negra now that the feat's been used as best as he possibly can, and then start trying to grind down the attrition game, primarily probably through the conquest.
That's kind of what I see happening, too. Like, he's got to get through this turn and the next one. And then after that, you know, Denegra's a very scary caster, but once the Withering's gone, a lot of that scary goes away.
I missed it earlier. I forgot to mention that First Blood in the Nyss Civil War goes to Trent, you know. As 10 of them walked up and all shot their bows into the same Nyss at the same time.
Killed one.
And just
got him.
You know. Do you think they yell that? That's their battle cry?
I don't think so.
Got him! No.
That'd be terrifying in its own way.
Murder elves coming out of the woods screaming, got him? Yes.
So Silas allows Jamie to upkeep that Iron Flesh that's on the Nyss Hunters for free. Arcane Assist.
Yep. Good old Silas Wishlanier, man. That guy is so solid.
Yeah, he's great.
Kador does not lack for strong Warcaster attachments between him and the Wardog.
Yeah, it's a tough choice.
Depends on your caster, really, right?
Well, of course. You know, there's always one way you want to go.
Yeah. So, Covenant Joe, Covenant Grigorovich, looks like he was not affected by the Withering whatsoever. So he's going to walk up and he's going to help out his remaining Winter Guard. I think he's going to pull his pistol out and I think he's going to shoot one of the Devil Shadow Mutineers right in their face.
He's going to try. Now, remind me, do his abilities affect himself as well as the unit? Or
yeah,
is it,
yeah, okay. Any of his speeches, they affect him and the unit he targets.
I don't have a whole lot of experience playing Kador myself.
So, Grigorovich has taken his hand cannon out, and Morlin gets shot right in the face.
It's really hard being one of the Devil Shadow Mutineers.
You die a lot, and you get right back to just keep dying.
It's like being a Mechanithral, but you smell less.
It's like a really bad Groundhog's Day.
Yes. Both players are kind of laughing and joking back and forth. Love seeing that.
Well, yeah. I mean, like we mentioned earlier, our community is so awesome about just having good games and having fun. I mean, that's what this is all about. This is the Iron Gauntlet. This is one of the most top high-skill level games you're ever going to watch between some of the best players in the world. And they're still just laughing and having fun, right?
Jamie's checking his control area.
Which is much smaller than normal.
Less than impressive under the Withering.
So the Tinker took his pistol out, tried to shoot a Mechanithral, failed. Apparently it was lost at the bottom of the heap.
Well, he found the gun, not the bullets.
Ah, there you go. Y'all, I found his gun.
Jimmy's pointing at that flag. I wonder what he's thinking.
He's thinking, I got to contest this flag. Like, if I don't go and take care of this, I'm going to lose the game.
Well, obviously that's what he's thinking. I mean, I wonder what his plan is.
Oh, well,
I mean, of course they're both thinking, I've got to win this game.
Well, what you think, yeah. Yeah, I think at this point,
Winter Guard Infantry going.
I think Trent's on plan scenario, and I think Jamie is on plan stop you winning scenario and just grind you to bits.
Well, they had a pretty effective first turn of doing that, first turn of shooting. I don't know. I keep forgetting, though, that Trent's still got all these Nyss Hunters.
Yeah.
That's terrifying.
Well, I mean, by the same token, look how many Nyss Hunters Jamie has that are unaffected by the Withering.
Well, I can't see them right now because if I say, oh, they have, well, yeah, that's true.
And there's still Alexia, too, up there. Mm-hmm. She can start making Thrall Warriors.
Yes, she can. Those are also terrifying. So we're going to have advanced.
We see that Trent used his Iron Gauntlet feat token, one of the many unique prizes that Iron Gauntlet finalists receive.
They get some pretty cool Iron Gauntlet swag.
So it looks like one of the Winter Guard main attack on a Macanthrall, but they're just, they got so many debuffs happening right now, it's not looking good for them. They're going to make a couple other shots, see what they can get done, see what kind of damage they can put out there. So that was a CRA into Boomhowler from some of the Winter Guard, and they hit him, and they do nothing.
They do nothing. Arm 16 is nothing to sneeze at.
Oh, when you're being shot at by withering, crippling, grasped Winter Guard. It helps. Not the worst. Conquest is walking up, being mad at life. Walked his hot 2 inches under the withering.
You know, I understand why they're shooting at the Boomhowlers, though, right? Like, at least they can kill that.
You just have to get Boomhowler off the table, too.
Yeah.
Like, you can't let him live. Not with a giant force on the table that he could technically hide out, you know, start hiding behind and doing all kinds of... You don't want that. So it looks like the Conquest took a shot at Boomhowler, missed, deviating. This was the big guns, so one of the four JOEs. I mean, he's got minus four to his attack roll.
That's still a big... That's a big AOE.
So he's going to hit a bunch of Mechanithralls, possibly one of the Wither Shadow Combine.
Point of damage to Boomhowler.
And it's time to start seeing if some zombies die. And that's a dead zombie. That might have been a dead zombie.
Just one.
No, that was just the big guns. So let's see what he's going to do with the secondary.
Looks like creeping barrage.
I imagine so, right? He can't have this place get flooded with Mechanithralls.
No, cannot afford that.
Every time we cut back and I see that koala, it looks more and more crazy. Look at it right now. Its eyes are all wide. It's like, hey, guys, you playing War Machine?
I was thinking the exact same thing.
Is it got flags and Winter Guard? You're like, dude, calm down. He did look a little psychotic.
That's a lot of templates down. So that that Conquest is feeling pretty safe right now.
Good evening, gentlemen. Here's my wall of bullets.
There he is. Old crazy eyes.
Look at that thing.
Look at him.
That has so much of this Red Bull. That's what
I look like the day after Lock and Load.
You're going to roll boxcars, box cars.
Some discussion happening on the board right now.
Yeah. Hey, are a wall of bullets good? Yeah. Nope, they're real good.
No, not between the models, between the players.
Oh.
So discussing that a unit can still receive a run order despite the unit leader being in the withering. The leader just cannot run because he's in the withering, but the rest of the unit can. Looking at the clock, 26 minutes and 24 minutes left.
Yeah.
Both players have used about the same amount of time.
Jamie's still got a lot left to go this turn, though.
That's absolutely true.
Hey. So one of the Nists that was affected by the withering moves. But looks like the rest of them are going to start getting in position. It might be Nis on Nis time.
That'd
Maybe.
Be Nis.
Maybe. What? What'd you say?
That'd be Nis.
Oh. Plummer, I love your jokes.
Thanks. I stole that one from Ed. He did it in the last game.
Oh, did he?
He did.
I don't love it anymore.
Nis advancing. Valachev's a great model.
Mm-hmm.
Love that hat.
Absolutely. I really like him running with a tactical Arcanist core under Zergova too.
Oh, that's so good.
Oh,
so good.
All right. See Jamie rolling his dice.
So actually, looks like he's moving this up, and he's going to try and he might be trying to clear out one of those Necrosurgeons. You know, they've got Sack Pawn onto the Stitch Thralls, so that's going to slow things down. But
well, he's got a lot of shots though.
He does have a lot of shots. Good thing about these Nists, of course, is they have Hunter, so they completely ignore any sort of forest. So, yeah, this table's got two forests in a pretty central location on the table, but the two groups of Nists fighting over them, they don't care. Doesn't matter at all. They've got Pathfinder. They've got Hunter.
They've got swords. They've got bows.
They've got swords. They've got bows. They live in the woods. They don't care about the forest.
The Zephyr happening here, not a surprise.
Yep. Zephyr and them Nis up, getting him in a better position. So I have to imagine if he's going this far forward, he is absolutely going after the Necrosurgeons.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I see that he's leaving a charge lane there for Alexia. So I imagine she's going to go murder mode here in a bit.
Oh, yeah. I think she's going for Echoes. So, another one of those ticks. Jamie is rolling his dice in his hands. I don't know what it is. I love people's nervous tics, the things they do. Right. Two-man CRA from the Nis Hunters. Targeting Mechanithral. Hits him. Kills him.
So, yeah, looks like one of the Nis aiming. We're getting a CRA going in on the Necrosurgeon, trying to take her out.
Let's see.
So, that should hit with the CRA.
And
yep,
pops her. Outside of Sack Pawn range, so he loses one. Now those Stitch Thralls just become speed bumps, though.
Creepy, creepy speed bumps.
Creepy speed bumps. Bag full of body parts.
All right. Looks like the few remaining shots are going Nis on Nis.
Yeah, might as well. When in doubt, shoot an elf.
Wow. That's why the Retribution invaded with sayings like that. When in doubt, shoot an elf.
Pause the clock.
So they're just pausing the clock. They're having the judge do some LOS checks right now to see which of the Nis have LOS to Sylena.
And by LOS, I mean line of sight. So we're going to take a second here while they figure this out. We're going to check in on the cosplay transformation of Marisha Ray. She's going to be becoming a Scar. It's pretty fantastic. We have some makeup artists here from Espionage Cosmetics. Mm-hmm. They're here this weekend, and they've brought these awesome War Machine and Hordes nail wraps. And they're doing partial manicures for our attendees, and those are available on sale in the store. They're sort of a geek makeup company, and they make a lot of really cool stuff. So those War Machine Hordes nails wraps are great. We'll check back in on that later. Marisha's going to look pretty awesome. I can't wait.
So they're transforming her into
Scar
right now?
Scar Ravenman right now.
Wow, that's pretty awesome. So by the time that this or maybe the next round is done, we're going to have live action Scar up on the stage.
It takes a couple hours, and then there she'll be.
Oh, wow. A couple hours. That's pretty rad.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty rad.
They've got airbrushes and all kinds of stuff.
And this is the actress that was in a quarter.
Yes.
Scar. Yeah.
Yes.
Cool. Back to Alexia murdering elves. Looks like her and her also horrible smelling horse have charged into the Nyss and are going to get some damage done. Wow. Hit that one so hard it turned sideways. He literally got tilted.
What?
Look at him.
Oh.
Look.
That's a problem.
It's a solution.
Depending on who you are.
Right.
No, and they're those Thrall Warriors we were talking about.
Yeah. I think she had two or three souls.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it looks like it was.
Terrifying. Clocks are paused again.
So we got a judge call right now. I'm not exactly sure what they're doing at the moment, but they're checking some measurements. A little hard to pick up on the exact details of the issue.
And once again here, old crazy ass watching the game very intently.
Are his eyes moving? Or is it just my imagination? Look at him.
All right, so they're back to the game.
I can't focus on the game.
Neither can he. Look at those eyes.
All right, so we're back to the game. They resolved. Looks like it was a charge. Yeah, a throwaway charge on Aiko's to see how far he'd go before, or how the charge line was legal.
Looks like a miss.
Yeah, looks like they both went in on Aiko's, and it didn't work out for him. You can see Trent doing a little sort of like fist pump there in excitement that Aiko's is still alive. Mib.
Great Bear's running. That's also impressive cardio and all that armor.
Great Bears are. I guess they weren't affected by the withering?
Well, apparently not.
I didn't see how close they were.
I think they were out.
I can't help but laugh every time I see him.
He's all I can look at.
So Silas is advancing, getting into a better position.
Great.
So the Great Bears are obviously in contest range here.
So we're going to take another look over here at Marisha Ray.
Okay.
So you can see they're doing some highlights on her clavicle, kind of giving her that deathly pallor.
No. I'm looking at the eyes. Does she have the contacts in already?
Well, I can't see now, unfortunately.
It's okay.
They're kind of giving her that deathly pallor.
There you go. She got the scar eyes going.
Yeah, and the scar eyes are. Oh, that is terrifying. That's even scarier than the drop bear. And behind her, you can see all the armor laid out. They did a great job on that. I can't wait to see it.
Yeah, that's cool, man. I didn't even know that was happening. So all of a sudden, you're like, hey, look what we're doing. Lock and load, full of interesting surprises. So it ships back to Trent's turn.
Mm-hmm. And upkeeping Crippling Grasp for free with the Wither Shadow combo.
Yep, the Wither Shadow.
Good choice.
Jamie's doing what he can to stop the scenario of victory, which, I mean, Trent's got a long way to go now because of that previous turn. He's still sitting on zero EZPs.
You know what? If I were a good enough player to see that, I think I would have had to go for it too, though. For those 3 points that he shot for and missed.
It would have been 3 points under with Denny's feet up.
Yeah. 0-0, though, still.
It's going to be a close game. This might be a game that goes to time, to be honest.
It could. Those clocks are not looking healthy right now.
You get a lot done in 16 minutes in a War Machine game.
That's true.
Especially when your models are getting whittled down.
Well, there's that. Trent is exclaiming his plan to kill the objective this time. And confirming some defensive stats.
Yeah, so Trent is still on plan, destroy objective.
Mm-hmm.
We'll have to see. I'm sure he has a better view of what's in contest range of the Cadoran flag. It's not the conquest, so that's good.
There's that.
But yeah, as soon as it becomes the conquest, you have a whole new set of problems.
Change plans.
You don't have to change them, but you have to consider how you're going to remove a giant, 20-story tall robot.
Yeah.
Who's being like, nope, you can't have that.
Nope.
I can't wait for the finals. I can't wait to see people play on that table. It's going to be so good.
Yeah, I'm excited to see what all the players at home in the Twitch stream, I have to say.
Yeah. And one of these two players, they're going to go on to the gauntlet round. After this, it's straight gauntlet round. 75-point games.
75-point games in newly constructed lists.
Yeah.
So. Trent is looking at ranges towards that conquest. Oh my goodness, that pistol wraith survived.
Well, nothing could get to him.
Oh, the withering. Right.
And crippling grasp. Yeah, that's been happening for a while now.
I think I must have just written him off when we talked about it.
Nope, he's got a soul.
Good for him.
This looks like the War Witch Siren is being pointed at.
Charging the conquest.
Nope, he's going to charge the conquest, hope to survive creeping barrage, and get that shadow bind off.
No damage from creeping barrage.
Wow.
Good for her.
Okay, so conquest has been hit, locked in place. Shadow bind on your colossal. It's rough, man.
Yeah, it's never a good thing.
So he's still obviously on plan scenario, right? He's got to blow up that objective. He's got to dominate with Denegra on the flag, keep her safe, kill anything that's in that area. And the Conquest can't move next turn.
Nope, sure can't.
So Jamie'd have to, depending on what he loses, run Nis over to try and get some contesting models or just switch to a completely different plan, obviously. But
he's got options.
So Iacos jumps out of melee.
I always laugh when I picture that.
Just him backflipping. Like a bunch of Thrall Warriors come up and swing, and he's like, hi-ya! And he just jumps backwards into Lexia.
Yeah, like a kung fu movie.
Hits one-shots.
One-shots her.
Yeah, one-shots Alexia.
Oof.
Iacos, kung fu master.
Yeah.
God, that guy is so scary. Didn't the beginning of this, didn't we say? What a scary super solo he is.
He is a monster.
You're
a straight monster. Some thinking, some thoughts. So we're going to take another look at Marisha. Those eyes are awful. So it looks like they're putting some shadow below the clavicles. And the makeup artist from Espionage are talking about the techniques they're going to want to use to make sure it looks completely right, and Mersh is nodding in agreement.
Listening to you cosplay or commentate cosplay makeup makes me realize that we have a really weird relationship, Michael.
Yeah?
Yeah. You're a good friend, but just, yeah, it's weird.
I don't even know what that means, Will.
So we have the Withershadow walking up, Dark firing a Thrall Warrior, and boom, goes the Dynamite. Trent moving his fancy feet token.
Mm-hmm. You know, the Iron Gauntlet finalists are not the only people who received a feet token this weekend, though.
Everybody.
Our friends over at Broken Egg Games made some awesome lock and load feet tokens for all of our attendees.
Yep,
and
yep.
They picked up when they registered, so those were very cool.
We also had some faction logoed spray templates that we were giving out in events.
Pretty fantastic. I was very surprised to see those, and they're very cool.
So it looks like the other Wither Shadow cast Puppet Master
on
one of the Devil Shadow Mutineers. Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that. Rock Bottom's Money Shot on the Devil Shadow Mutineers.
Yep, so Rock Bottom's throwing Money Shot out. So we have a Puppet Mastered Money Shot at Zira. That's going to do some damage.
Mm-hmm. The look on that bear's eyes is pretty much exactly how I feel about that.
Boom Howler Rage Howls, so that's back up. So just dropping those attack rolls. It's
Rage Howler.
The other grunt, he's still got one other member of his unit. Kills one of the Nisses over in the woods, so just make every attack count. Chip away at some models.
Yep.
Kill a guy here, kill a guy there.
Kill a guy everywhere.
Kill the Yep. Good talk. So the Devil Shadow Mutineers must be what's going to go kill the objective. Zero with Weapon Master shots.
Yeah.
Also with a Pistol Wraith, the Soul has been on a damage boost. Like, he has options to just shoot it off the table. We'll see what he goes with, though.
So, look like a Bone Jack Advance.
Yep.
Shooting its gun. Shooting his own Mechanthrals?
Yep, shooting Mechanthrals.
Yep. All right. Sounds like a plan.
Looks like no Necrosurgeon, so he just might be opening a lane for something. Well, they're sort of discussing things. You know, we'd also like to thank Geek and Sundry for broadcasting the Lock and Load Twitch streams. If you're watching now and you're new to Privateer's Twitch stream, we hope you follow our channel. We'll be giving a free Privateer pin to one of our followers in chat as soon as we hit 2,700 followers.
That's right.
Yeah, man.
Those Privateer pins are really awesome, too. Like, they can... I've seen some awesome collections. I love the chibis, especially, are my favorites.
I have a bunch of the Minion stuff. Well, and the Cephalix stuff. You know I'm a huge Cephalix nut.
Believe me, I know how much you love Cephalix.
Yeah. Thanks for painting the army for me again.
Well, you're welcome, Will. Stitch Thrall's walking around.
Yep, Stitch Thrall's is getting in position. Cool. Oh, man. That Nis fight's happening. Looks like Selena just died on Jamie's side.
Oof.
Yep.
She's not the one you want to lose.
More Nis dropping. So, CRAs. It's getting bad. It's getting real bad for those Nis. So the Nis passed their command check, even though they just lost a ton of their guys.
If you want to take a look at those pins, if you're new and you've never really seen Privateer pins, you can go to privateerpress.com/pins. That's P-I-N-S. You can see the entire line. There's a lot of really awesome pins.
You talking about the pins I was talking about earlier?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The ones that we're giving away when we hit 2,700 followers.
Oh, cool.
So
cool.
Follow now.
I was like, that came out of nowhere, man. I was like, what are we talking about? Oh, we're talking about cool pins. Okay.
Yeah.
Rad. Speaking of other cool things, though, this game, though. Man, you
remember when there were a ton of models on the table, and now there aren't?
Oh, that was a good time, yeah, when there were a ton of models. So the Devil Shadow Mutineers, they're activating. Mar's going to walk up next to the flag. Yeah, Zero's advancing. I assume she's aiming the guns at the objective. Zero shoots the objective, so yep, here we go.
Yep.
And I think that's Snake Eyes, but Puppet Master. Yeah, so gets the reroll.
Puppet Master, for when you roll double ones.
So, got some damage on it with the first lick. Puppet Master let her miss that double one, or reroll the double one. And the second
Snake
attack,
Eyes?
Yeah, with Snake Eyes. So Zero walks up with Weapon Master pistols and is like, is that a gobber with a trunk full of pistols? I imagine that's what happened.
Of course.
And one of the Wither Shadow was like magically reminding them, like, you need to shoot this thing.
Oh, right.
Oh, right.
But seriously.
So the pistol wraith now.
Ah, that is the third. Oh, okay, there were three dice there. I saw the two ones and I got scared.
So that was the pistol wraith. You know, aiming, using the soul to boost damage, shooting, doing no damage. So exactly what I thought was going to happen, right? The Pistol Wraith was going to do the damage, shoot at it. Devil Shadow Mutineers were going to shoot at it, trying to take the objective off. It's just that Trent is having the hardest time killing that objective.
Well, you know, he should roll higher.
The best advice in professional War Machine competitive play, roll better.
No, you know, he's making a lot of really smart plays here, and it definitely could have worked, but unfortunately his dice just weren't cooperating, and that's going to happen sometimes.
He made a lot of smart plays, but he just should have rolled better? Okay.
I just need to make better plays when I play.
I don't know, man. Your dice turn against you sometimes pretty fierce. But yeah. I've seen it happen.
I know.
Yeah.
So there again.
Oh my god. Nope, I'm not looking at it. Right,
so
looking at Jamie.
So Jamie is.
Turn gets shipped back to Jamie P, who I'm sure is only relieved that that objective didn't get blown up.
Mm-hmm.
Now the time crunch is becoming
very real.
Very real. Like I said, there's a lot you can get done in 15, 16 minutes, and Jamie really needs to get a lot done this
Here
turn.
We are in round four of the game.
Yep.
Top of four.
Yep.
Jamie still has his feet, too.
Jamie that does is, still have his feet.
That is worth stating. You know, there's not a whole lot of heavy armor on the other side. So
No. It's just dice rolls that say, I don't even have to roll them. You're dead.
Yes.
Mechanithralls under Esource's feet die real quick to conquest main guns.
That is absolutely true.
Not that that's what's going to happen, but I was just stating a fact.
Sure.
Let's see. So the Conquest can't go anywhere right now. He's shadowbound.
Right. I don't know if he needs to go anywhere.
Oh, he would love to. He would love to under Seashore's feet, walk up, throw Boomhauer at Denegra, knock her down, and just watch everything obliterate her.
Well, who wouldn't love to see that?
Denegra.
And Trent.
Oh, yeah, Trent would be super sad.
It's a great game.
We're doing our best not to make it that way, but it is a great game.
Well, we fail at even that.
So the Nists are moving over. Obviously, two of them are going to take their claymores out and be like, stop yelling at our warjack.
Yeah. And then they'll swing their swords and scream, got him.
Right. Got him.
All right, so we got Nist charging. And a Warwitch Siren.
Well,
he wants to move that conquest.
Well, he still ain't doing it this turn.
Not doing it this turn, but making it happen.
So, we got a charge. Valachef is, I assume, just running into position.
Mm-hmm.
And here we go. I like the template there. Nice job, Sons of Brag. It's a nice little call out. I can only imagine that's what that stands for.
Yeah, it must be.
Yeah.
Nice job, Sons of Brag.
Nice job, Sons of Brag. So it looks like there's a command check being made for engaging a terrifying entity here.
Tough check. Fails.
Yep. So.
Florida dice rolls here.
Yeah. So the Boomhallers are gone. Yeah. They've been removed.
That happened. So Conquest power striking Valachef.
Yep, right into Denny.
Yep. It's just I'm gonna punch my friend in the back.
Yeah. So he power struck him with the hope of slamming him into Denny, but the dice roll were a little short. So instead,
so really Valachef just had a real bad day.
Just imagine the visual of it. The Nist charge of Valachef is like, all right, yeah, got him. I like your charge, boys. Let's do it. And the Conquest is like, stop it. Just punch him in the back of the head. Sends him skidding face first across the ground.
Denegra's just watching like, what are you doing?
Valachef's last words were, wait! Just lands at Diddy's feet. She's like, why?
Behind the game here, you can see the rest of the events all hopping.
Yep. So Jamie P is reassessing his turn.
Back to Marisha for a minute here.
Getting them cheekbones, like, scar cheekbones.
Yep, it looks like they're using some kind of a putty, or it might be a wax. A lot of theatrical makeup, they use wax to build up the cheekbones and things like that.
Uh-huh.
So that's what they're doing now. They're sculpting her features to give her that really harsh look that Scar's going to have. Fascinating stuff.
Okay. So it looks like Covenant Joe just walked up before the mother landed, shot Zira, and Zira has died again.
That poor woman.
I don't know, man. She's basically a, you know, undead pirate.
I mean, it's a good life, right?
She's not a good person.
Well, sure. You don't know that.
No, I
do. Let's not judge.
Okay, I won't judge anymore.
Thank you.
I will judge that Conquest, because that was mean.
Oh, yeah.
Just hey,
blatantly mean.
Hey, Valachef. Do you think the Gobber Tinkerer started cheering?
What did Valachef do to Sorsha that she thought that was a...
Yeah, she told him to do it, right?
All right.
So Zira just got murdered as well. Matt... They're having a real bad time. So it's like the Withers... No, not the Withers.
Devil Shadow Mutineers are
the Devil
all
Shadow
dead.
Mutineers, yeah. They're all dead, so they ain't coming back this time. Devil Shadow Mutineers, Wither Shadow Combine. Blah, 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 blah. keep mixing them up.
It does make me want to get a bunch of Bart hats and make the Wither Shadow Mutineers.
Yeah, they could look nice. So it looks like the Great Bears just activated.
Yep.
Killed that pesky Warwitch Siren, which locked down the Conquest this time.
Mm-hmm. And those are some great-looking Great Bears, too.
Getting to that point. Models are starting to get real low on both sides of the table.
Yeah. Well, yes, that's definitely true, but still... tons of Nis Hunters up here.
So Sorsha is getting up there, getting ready for something.
She has a plan.
Yep. So Jamie ships turn back to Trent. Score is 0-0.
13 minutes to 8.5. So again, to anyone that's watching our stream for the first time, we're going to be giving away some Privateer Press pins once we hit 2,700 followers.
Yep. Yep.
So some free giveaways, and special thanks to the folks at Geek & Sundry for simulcasting Iron Gauntlet Finals 2015 from Lock & Load Game Fest in Bellevue, Washington.
If you want to check out those pins, what's that website again, Michael?
That was privateerpress.com/pins.
Cool.
Check out that Scornflakes pin.
It's a good one. It's a good one.
All right. Pistorius is aiming. Takes a shot at... kills a standard bear from the Winter Guard unit. And shooting into the objective.
Yep, yep.
I'm imagining a boost with that soul, you think, on damage?
There's no doubt in my mind he boosts. I will walk away from commentary right now if he doesn't boost damage on that objective.
Please boost a hit.
Why would you? So there's the hit.
There's the hit, and boost the damage.
Yeah. And let's see if Trent can roll better, as you so adequately put it.
See... he listens to me, good things happen.
That's a first. All right, so the objective's down. That is the first control point of this game scored.
Absolutely.
Trent gets a CP.
Trent 1, Jamie 0.
Yeah. So, see how it goes from here, because he still has to dominate it. If he can dominate this turn, he goes up to 3.
Mm-hmm.
And if he can lock onto that, but with that Conquest not being able to be held down anymore, this is not going to happen.
Do you have a preference when you play? Are you a big scenario player, or do you look for those assassination attrition wins? Like, what's your preference as a player?
Roll dice, kill things.
All right.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Now, it depends on the army I'm playing.
Sure. Of course. That has to come into it.
I do like a good aggressive game.
Yep.
Rock
bottom activating.
I like quick games.
You know me. I always go for the assassination.
I don't always go for an assassination necessarily, but spring, I like to be aggressive.
Miss on the Nis.
Miss on the Nis.
Sounds like a Dr. Seuss book.
Yeah. So it looks like one of Denny's Jacks is going to walk up.
Shooting a Nis under in the back. Miss that Nis.
The Nis that's contesting that flag right now, he's pouring everything he can into it to try and get rid of it. But he's still got the Great Bear sitting in a trench. And I think that is 4 inches, but I could be wrong. That Nis... no, if that Nis is contesting, those Great Bears have to be.
Oh, yeah. Scarlet Thrall coming up.
Yep. I'm going to guess Crippling Grasp on the Conquest. Crippling Grasp on the Conquest. It hits.
Like you thought he could move, but no.
Well, he can move, just well, very bad at it.
Iacus walking 6, jumping.
Yep, jump, leap, shoot. I assume he's going to try and drag somebody over.
Shooting at, is that Yarovich? No, Yarovich is up front. I think that's Volkov.
No, it's one of the Great
Bears. It doesn't matter. That's Dead Bear. Well, those were their names, Will. They have names.
No. couldn't quite catch which one just died, so I don't know what buff they lost there.
I know it's not Yarovich because I see him. I think it was Volkov, but I could be wrong.
Okay.
The Nis are moving up to that objective.
Yep.
The flag. Excuse me.
But if it was Yarovich, that means the Nis locks a circular strike.
It was absolutely not Yarovich.
Oh, you said it wasn't Yarovich. You thought it was who? You thought it was Volkov?
I think it was Volkov. I could be wrong.
That's Relentless Charge, which is probably still less than relevant right now. It's Kulsk that, granted, steady. They don't want to lose that right now.
Denegger's activating, so this will be running.
Yep.
All right.
Yep. So it's time to plan, dominate my own flag, score one on it, make you come to me. Then, if Jamie scoots over to start dealing with that, then he can swoop in with the solos over there and try and control that flag.
Yep.
Jamie's in a tough spot. It's not the best spot to be in. But if anybody can figure a way out of it, it's going to be him.
Sure thing. These are great players. That's one thing you don't understand if you haven't watched a whole lot of War Machine games. Like, I know a lot of people that I consider to be very good players, but these guys are just top-notch. Like, they see things that I could never see in a million years. They go for the plays that I would never think of. It's awesome to watch.
We may not even get to CPs, though. Those clocks are looking really low right now.
They are pretty low.
So Trent's done. Walked up. Made a few missed attacks. Shifts the turn back. He's at two control points, though, now that he dominated his own flag. So control point score is 2-0.
Two?
Trent to Jamie.
2-0. So Conquest speeding along 2 inches.
Chugging.
I barely see it.
Just look at him.
I know.
Just sitting in the background. Hey, guys.
Main gun shot boosted. At missed.
So he's trying to take out some of them Nis.
Yeah, well, there's a lot of them.
I mean, the AoE is going to deviate on somebody.
Mm-hmm.
It hits 5 Nis under that AoE.
So, miss and hit 5? I'll take it.
That's the power.
And that's 5 dead.
So, the command check by him got passed. They're not running off the table. If they had broke right there, that changes the game in a pretty interesting way.
Yeah. Fail command check there would have been brutal. I once played a game where in the top of 2, someone ran a Doom Reaver close to my Nis Hunters and they failed, and that game was pretty much over right then.
Yeah, sure. So the Conquest kept shooting things, and things kept dying. That's the long and short of what happened there.
Yep. It's mostly the short of it.
And those Nis, just both turns that somebody actually looked at them, they died in droves.
So there used to be Nis here, and now not so much.
So draw another circle right next to it. There used to be Nis there, too.
That's absolutely true.
Right. So the Great Bear's activated, and they're charging. Probably going to try and take out that Bone Jack. Still have some bodies in contest range of that flag. Looks like one attack missed. The backswing from one of the Great Bears into the Bone Jack hit, though. One of the Wither Shadow went down as well.
Mm-hmm.
And all the Bone Jacks have been replaced with templates, so that's no good for them.
Those are wreck markers.
Yes. Winter Guard are walking up. We're going to take some shots. Pistol Wraith down from the Winter Guard.
Is that the Winter Guard or was that Joe?
Joe is next to the Nice Job Sons of Brag template.
All right.
pretty sure that's Joe. Silas charges the Macanthro on the trench.
And Snake Eyes.
Snake Eyes. I was not built for this. I was not built for war.
All I brought was a stick.
A magical reach stick. But he wasn't built for war.
Built for...
The Goblin Tinkerer is charging the Mechanithral.
And he brought his cart with him. That is...
He's using point blank. So he rolls up with the gun, still didn't put bullets in it, and he misses. Aye, y'all. Jamie. Looks like ships the turn back to Trent. We're getting to that point where those 15 minimum seconds on the clock, it's going to matter real soon.
I mean, the nice thing for both players, and I say this very loosely, the nice thing is they don't have many models left, right? So they can at least get a full turn in pretty quickly now.
Well,
Jamie just inquired as to how much time he had left, was told he had 5 minutes left, and quickly took a swig of an energy drink. Looks like he's ready to amp up his speed.
Now, I can't tell whether or not Trent scored up to another CP there from dominating that flag. And last I checked, Trent should still be at two CPs from killing the objective in that one turn he dominated for sure. They don't see any of Jamie's models he would have gotten in contest range. That Conquest can't be in contest range.
Well, we'll go ahead and update that now. And, you know, here's our old friend.
Oh, man. It's all, hey, you know. Go ahead.
Honestly, this makes him a lot more terrifying. Could not resist.
It's all crazy koala. Hey, guys, want to play War Machine? No, crazy koala. No. Nobody wants to play with you.
You're not allowed to talk to the players right now.
Next one we play, if I just bring a huge base with that koala glue to it, will you be okay?
Yeah.
Just run it wherever I want.
It looks like there's an error in the points right now. Trent Denison has two control points. Jamie Perkins currently has zero. We're going to go ahead and make that change right now. We apologize for any confusion.
Yeah. The one thing we haven't gotten confirmation from our judges just yet is whether or not Trent's actually at three control points from Denny dominating that flag again at the end of Jamie's last turn. So the chances at three, we haven't had the word yet, but I'm sure we'll find out soon enough. So the Scarlock just walked up, and he ghost-walked Denegra. So this is going to be interesting.
Huh. Interesting to see what happens there.
Mechanthrall gets in the trench. Oh. I think Denny's about to walk over through the woods. Throw Scourge at that Mechanithral?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's about to happen.
Oh, I thought the Mechanithral was going to try and punch Sorcia.
No.
No, I think I see what's happening here.
But what's he got in position left?
Well, yeah, what's after that, though?
Unboosted Scourge. Snake Eyes it.
Double ones.
Doesn't matter.
He's real good at rolling that.
Doesn't matter. He's just going to drift it onto her, probably. So they figure out the deviation on that unboosted Scourge right now. See where it ended up at. They're being very precise with their measurements right now because they need to know the maximum range.
Absolutely.
Clocks are paused.
Well, yeah, clocks are paused.
So judge is coming in because this is super, super important. They need to know exactly how far this AVOE can deviate to determine the math of whether or not this AoE can even mathematically hit Sorcia. Because Sorsha being knocked down is kind of a big deal.
I mean,
because if Sorsha's not knocked down right now, they're figuring it out right now. We'll have word in a second.
So back to Marisha for a minute here. So you can see they've blended the makeup on her cheeks there. So she has her natural flesh tone. And but you can still see like the scarred, puckered look on them and the shaping. Right now they're airbrushing the rest of her skin to make it match the work they've done on the rest of her. And you can see the scars that they've built onto her clavicle. Very, very cool looking.
So it looks like Sorsha was hit by Scourge after determining the minimum drift distance.
Oof.
So Sorsha is knocked down. So Parasite's cast next. So Sorsha is knocked down and parasited.
So we got some more updates on winners. So our winners from Iron Gauntlet this round are David Bichamp, Michael Perrier, Jeremy Lee, David Smith, and Matt Sloop.
Wow. So Rock Bottom walks up, throws the flamethrower out there, sets Sorsha on fire, and gets 5 points of damage on her. This is looking real ugly.
I think it looks great.
So the winter guard up front got hit as well.
Love this excitement.
He's almost done. He's got 2 minutes. The other Mechanithral got killed by the spray. So Rock Bottom walked up and just sprayed a bunch of fools. So Dougal McNail's walking up. Quad iron
dudes. Oh, that's scary.
Oh, looks like Dougal walked into the melee range of the Great Bear and couldn't shoot.
That could be costly.
It already was. He couldn't shoot.
Well, I mean, seriously costly.
Oh, yeah. So Darkfire from some Wither Shadow into the knockdown, Sorsha. Rolling damage. Sorsha is alive with what looks like one box.
Oh,
Aikos walks up.
The leap.
Leaps 5 inches. What do we say? What do we say at the beginning of this game?
Aikos is a murder solo.
Harpoon hits. Boost damage. That's game.
That's a great game right there.
That
so
is an awesome
that is
game.
A assassination win for Trent Denison versus Jamie Perkins. Iacos got the kill on forward commander Sorsha.
Wow.
What a great game. That was fantastic to watch.
Both Jamie and Trent played such an awesome game, man. Such
absolutely.
An awesome game.
You know, Trent really went for that strong scenario play early in the game, and it was really exciting, and I thought he was going to get those 3 points. And then in the end, he had to turn his plan around and just go for the assassination and take the win.
And he shifted so well from playing for scenario to assassination. So it's just a great game.
Absolutely.
To watch.
You know what? Jamie played a great game too, though. Mm-hmm. I love watching these guys play every year. It's a real pleasure. Real pleasure. So we're going to be coming back with the first of the gauntlet rounds pretty shortly here.
Yeah.
Thanks for watching. I'm Michael Plummer, convention coordinator for Privateer Press.
And I'm Will Hungerford, organized play and volunteer coordinator here at Privateer Press. And we'll be back with you soon.
That's right.
That bear, though.
That bear.